Thank you. future, either what has happened this week, no matter what you really think you're about to face later today or tomorrow, when you know Christ, that hope is yours. Romans chapter 3, verse 24 through verse 26. Just read the testimony of Bobby King, where he shares what the cross means to him. These verses that we just read in Romans chapter 3 help us understand what the cross means to God. What the cross means to God. First of all, I think the cross means that God wanted to give a real demonstration of his righteousness. This is verse 25 again, because it goes all the way back. Scripture says God is holy. How can a holy God pass over the sins that have been committed? I've read the Bible at all, you know, throughout the centuries, there have been those times when God has dramatically judged sin all along the way. But it's not until we come to the cross that anything quite as serious or life changing. Everything culminates in the redemptive history of God. The cross. Everything. Verse 21 says, but man, in other words, God in his own time has made a decision. God says, but I'm going to show them humanity that I'm righteous, that I'm holy. Know that I'm serious about sin. I'm going to send my only son. I'm going to reveal to them my tremendous love. I'm going to let my son, my only begotten son, die on the cross publicly before a watching world as a propitiation by his blood through our Lord's blood on the cross appeased a holy God. It satisfied a holy God. It was the justice of God being carried out on the cross so that men and women like us, young people like us, could regain favor with God, the favor that was lost in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve sinned. Listen, God says, I sent my son so that you might be able to contain the perfect presence of God. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there can't be no remission of sin. None. If you ever want to know how serious sin is, just look at the cross. If you ever want to know how God feels about sin, gaze on the relationship with God. Look at the cross. Jesus. God's only begotten Son. The Lord of glory. The one whom angels bow down in worship and cry out for all eternity. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, was God naked on the cross. Drenched with his own sweat and blood and spit and shame and agony and humility on the cross. Jesus was suspended between heaven and earth in that kind of humiliating way before watching. The Bible talks about our Lord crushed and afflicted and wounded for our transgressions. That's not even the half of what he went through on the cross. The cross is beautiful, but the cross is dangerous. It's violent. Thank you. Sprinkled more. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, you through the eternal Spirit, offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Wow! How much more? If the blood of a calf, if the blood of a goat could give temporary forgiveness, if it could temporarily appease the holy, righteous wrath of God, the author of Hebrews says, how much more will the blood of the eternal Son of God, who never sinned, how much more will that impact your life? And did God do it this way? I think because of the sacrifice of infinite value to turn away that fierce, holy kingdom of only God Himself in the person of Christ Jesus can make such. Thank you.
lost its sin of forgetfulness, and God has posted a no-pushing sign. There is therefore now no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Our sins have been forgiven. See, let me say something. When I say that, that's the foundation for the church to erupt and explode in praise and adoration. Our sins, the very things that held me down and kept me from a relationship with God, have been rolled away at the cross. At the cross! At the cross, it's okay to cry! At the cross! Years ago, when secret churches were just coming into the door, some were being invited and some were coming to practice in the church hall. One author said that he and his church had decided that they would do everything possible to eliminate any cross from their building structure. Inside, outside, classrooms, whatever, he said, we don't want to put up a cross because we feel it would be an offense. Those who were seekers have not been saved. Let me say something to you. He was right in one part of it. The cross is always an offense. Why? Because to an unsaved person, it's ridiculous. It's foolish. I want to say to you that the foolishness of God is the foolishness of the cross. Praise God, is our redemption, our wisdom, our power, our wealth, our joy, our sanctification, our eternal security. Cross. You don't get excited. You can't catch a blaze. You can't get on fire. When you talk about the cross, the spiritual. This meal that we're about to enjoy today, this meal that we're about to partake of, it's not a ritual. It's not a ritual. It's a memorial. It's a vehicle. It's a tool. All that Jesus meant for this meal to do is to refresh us and remind us and bring us back to the core of our faith. Remember what Jesus did on the cross. Every time you eat this bread, every time you drink this cup, you are proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ until He returns. Every time. It takes us back. It takes us back to the cross. And we're saying to the Lord, that is the heart. Deserved to die. He did a debt he never actually owed. He stood in the
lambs were sacrificed for all demands. He always supplies. See, that means salvation is the work of Almighty God from first to last. One more point that we're going to observe is what was the reward. It's at the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ that God demonstrated his awesome. We are justified freely by this grace. Freely means without cause. It means without merit. Salvation comes to us without a cause in us. Salvation is a free gift of God to the entire universe. There's nothing in you, there's nothing in me that causes God to want to save us, but the works. God saves us. He does it despite the fact that we don't deserve it. Here, the beautiful definition of grace. Here it is. It's what you need but don't deserve. In the minute you can say, well, I deserve it, it's no longer grace. No, grace is what you need. It's what I need. God declares us righteous when we have nothing but the sewage of sin running through our veins. There's none righteous. Not Billy Graham, not the Pope, not the past saints that we've read about and admired, no preacher, no denominational head, there's none. Righteous, no, not one. We've all got sewage, the sewage of a sin nature running through our veins. But grace comes along. It saves people who don't deserve it. God saves people who deserve condemnation. God saves people in spite of themselves. God saves people contrary to their record. Thank you.
writing in 1 Corinthians 11 says, I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. On the very night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed and took bread, he took some bread and gave thanks, and he broke it and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Now do this in remembrance of me. As God has disclosed before we move one step further, would you do your best to search your heart and ask the Lord to see if there'll be anything in your life, anything in your heart that would hinder you from being able to remember and observe this meal with a clean mind. Come to me in a spirit of desperation, say, Lord, I want to come remembering, I want to come and be renewed. If there's something in my life right now that I must confess, I must let you deal with. If we confess our sins, the scripture says it's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So even if the resistance placed off in which you search your heart, just take a moment of meditation. A moment of meditation and say, Lord, I want to be clean. Lord, I want to be clean. Father, as we come before you, we realize that the bread and the wine they simply serve as tremendous reminders of what you so wonderfully achieved for us. 2,000 years ago, outside the city of Jerusalem, on a rough wooden cross, that cross drenched with your blood and sweat, that cross which was so violent and so ugly and scandalous for us. It's there by faith that the burden of our sin rolled away where you may not temporarily but permanently come for our sins. Thank you for the cross. Bless us now. Help us to eat this meal in a manner that's worthy to you. As we look forward to eating this bread, may we be reminded of your body. God, help us to remember that while our salvation is free, being such a tremendous Christ, help us as we eat this bread to really allow ourselves to remember and look back to that horrific Friday. Thank you.
fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Ephesians 1:7, in Him, I would say, in Him alone, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. Please, the Father, that in Him, that is Jesus, all the fullness should come, and by Him, to reconcile all things to Himself, by Him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of the cross. Father, in Jesus' name, we come today, observing the Spirit and remembering specifically that it is the shed blood of Jesus Christ, His sacrificial death on the cross, on our behalf, that allows us to worship so freely. It's His death on the cross that allows us to live an immediate, complete, unrestricted access to You. It is the death of our Lord on the cross that gives us the beautiful privilege of calling Him Father, Son. Because of the cross, we're no longer far away, we're no longer outcasts, we're no longer aliens, we're children, we're citizens, we're heirs of God, we're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Because the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all our sin. We repent. We are Christ, if you've been saved, we love you, grace you. As a member of this